Paul Sears is a drummer who has a really crazy history.
And, fact.
Yes. And he has detailed a lot of amazing stories about his career in his new book. It's called Angels and Demons. It's published by Stairway Press.
Angels and Demons That Play.
Angels and Demons That Play, yes. So yeah, it's a new book on Stairway Press. It's a really great book. I've known Paul a few years now. We met on Craigslist.
2011?
Yeah, something like that. And yeah. I knew you were an amazing drummer, but I didn't know that you could write. This is a great book, man.
Good. I'm glad you like it. It was a real chew to do.
Yeah.
And I've always liked to talk. I've had the gift of gab. And basically what that book is me gabbing and writing it down.
Yeah. Well, it's funny because as I was reading it, I could hear you speaking. Like, I read this whole book in your voice. And it's very clearly your voice.
So. And you didn't go insane.
No, I did not. So before we get too deep into that, for people who don't know much about you or your history, why don't you share some of the major highlights of bands you've been in and work you've done?
Well, for most of 40 years, I was in a group called the Muffins. In Washington, D.C., and we started a homegrown record label back in the 70s, and the Muffins were, oh gosh, probably the fifth or sixth band that I was in, and I joined up with a group of people, the Muffins, who were amazingly the only people in that area or anywhere that I had run into at that time. At the young age of 22, that were into the Virgin Records and the European progressive rock scene, Henry Cow, Fred Frith, Gong, yada yada yada, and they were the only people that I had ever met in my life that were into that sort of scene and listened to that kind of music. So it was like a ready-made club. And we got on really, really great and made a splash in the 70s, and we lasted until 1981. Our last album then, during the Mark II phase, was with Fred Frith, and that's actually resulted in my favorite record of all of ours ever, which is 185.
It's right there.
All right. Yeah. That's the only record that we made after a tour where we really knew the music when we walked into the studio. Mm-hmm. We knocked that thing out in 2 days recording, 3 days assembly and mixing, and then off to New York for mastering.
Is that the record where in the book you share a story about doubling your drum part and it was like
not
so
me,
precise?
Not me, it was Tom Scott's saxophone part.
Oh, okay.
And it's the alto solo that's in the Antidote to Dry Dock tune. Mm-hmm. And he had played that solo the same way for so long it became a part. And it's pretty insane solo. It's probably 20 seconds long, if that, but listen to it. We'll be right back. And
I did today before.
After Tom played that, the engineer and Fred were having a chuckle and said, "Wow, bet you can't do that again." And Tom said, "Take the first track out and give me another track." And I thought those gentlemen were going to wet their pants because it's so spot on. You can't tell it's two saxophones.
Right. So.
But we knew our parts.
So yeah. After 185.
After 185, the Muffins sort of ennui set in. A couple of these guys were starting families, and so the band drifted apart. And Billy and I kept the house for about another year. Mm-hmm. And then he started a family. My dad got ill. He was diagnosed with stomach cancer. And so I moved home to help with the family. And not much music happened of any organized fashion until the very late 80s, when I went to see a dear friend of mine's group, the Teresa Gunn Band, great group from the Washington area. And she had an amazing bass player. He was playing far beyond what the music needed. He was really quite the ham bone. And this was a guy named Mark Smoot. And I decided, "Teresa, I just might swipe your bass player." So in between sets, I got to talk to him and found out that he was not only a Muffins fan, but a fan of all the other stuff that we were that we all shared in common with the Muffins. So, he and I played together for about a month, and just the two of us improvising and working on systems. And then we built a band called Chainsaw Jazz.
I would like to introduce a band out of Washington, D.C. It's called Chainsaw Jazz.
Well, that long time there. Yeah. Back when the web became publicly available, I jumped on it. And just for spits and giggles, I started looking around for the Muffins. And I'm like, wow, there's a page here about the Muffins on some news group, so I printed out. And then about 3 weeks later, I had filled up a notebook that fat with stuff people had been writing about the Muffins on the web, on various news groups like Alt Music Progressive or whatever it was back then, back in the early 90s. And so there was so much written about us, I got a bug up my butt to try to get the band back together. Nobody had any real confidence in that ever happening. But in 1998, while I was working with another group, 9353, I finally, the stars aligned, and I had accumulated enough evidence to present to the guys that, hey, you've all had your families and paid your mortgages and all this neat stuff, you know, you want to play some music again? And lo and behold, they did. And so we had another run from 1998 until 2016 or 2015, 2016.
Right. And you released the Live at Orion DVD, which I've got there.
That was done in 2002 at Orion Sound Studios with the help of several of our friends.
Yeah.
And Tom, this is an amazing thing for you techno people out there. Tom Scott put together that DVD, edited it all together, rendered it, did everything on a Windows 98 DOS computer. And I think it took him 72 hours to render it or something.
All right, I got to watch it again with this new appreciation.
Yeah. Cool. And then we made, you know, we made several more albums after that, and we went to Italy and we went to France and did not see the Queen's underpants.
All right, so you as a drummer, you're one of the most powerful drummers I've ever heard play a kit, and one of the things that astounded me so much about your playing is your ability to compose parts when the music may be so off, you know, like there's just so little to grasp onto rhythmically or melodically, but somehow your parts unify everything. So I wanted to get a sense of where are you coming from as a listener and as a musician, and how do you view the drums compositionally, you know, in the context of a group like the Muffins?
Well, two things come into play. Mm-hmm. One, I've been playing with other warm bodies in bands since 1967. Mm-hmm. So I've got a lot of experience. I grew up with a lot of music that the 70s progressive style bands were borrowing, you know, so when I would hear Frank Zappa or Renaissance or Genesis or somebody, I'd go, oh, that's Stravinsky, that's Poulenc, that's Johanna Lane, you know, whatever. You know, so I had all this music in my brain, thanks to my dad, ever since I was a little kid. And improvising, I never really did until 1972. I was working with a very fine piano player named Steve Freeman. No idea where he is these days, but he played grand piano and a Rhodes, but he preferred to play his Yamaha Grand that he had in his apartment. And he and I had jammed, and he said to me one day, bring your drum set over to my house and we are going to just do an improvisation, just grand piano and the drums. And it was just one of the most liberating fun days I ever had, playing off this guy and have him play off me. So then I went off later on and worked in a couple of more rock bands, Tinsel Tin, and I went to New Jersey and worked with groups Pandemonium and Whisk. And in Whisk, the guitar player and one of the main guys was Kenny Siegel, who designed the Snarling Dog guitar effects pedals that you see everywhere nowadays. Really great guy. And after a year or two of pooting around with them and having fun and joining the New Jersey Musicians Union, which was a trip, it was AFL-CIO in those days, I was frankly getting bored with the direction of the band, and I'd gone back to visit my family over the holidays, and I ran into my first ever bass player from my first band, Pepe Gonzalez. Pepe had since evolved and gotten heavy into jazz, and he said, why don't we do a fusion group, you know, like Weather Report, you know, Mahavishnu type thing. Uh-huh. And so I said, okay. So I went back to New Jersey and had to sever my ties with those guys. We're all still friends. and came back to DC and built a band with Pepe. Again, I always start with a bass player. If I'm going to start a project and I have any control over it whatsoever, I start with the bassist, get tight, and then we bring in other people. And that's what we did. And we put together a really cool group called Magic Theater, which was, the biggest influence was probably 70s era Electric Miles. You know, Agartha type stuff.
Right.
And then Pepe started bringing more straight up jazz into the picture. And that's anathema to me. I didn't want to play in a jazz band. Didn't then, don't now, and won't tomorrow.
It could be argued that the Muffins is a jazz
so
band.
Then not really. Well, some people could, yeah. So it's all perspective and presentation.
Yeah.
To the rock guys, the Muffins were a jazz band. To the jazz guys, the Muffins were a rock band because we were loud and had amplifiers. And then a friend of mine, actually he wasn't a friend of mine yet, the guitar player that had previously left the Muffins was a guy named Michael Zentner. And he contacted my bass player in Magic Theater wanting to do some music. And Pepe said, well, really, I'm not into that European avant-garde rock stuff, but my drummer is. And he put Michael in touch with me. And although to this day, Michael and I have never played together, Michael introduced me to the Muffins. And the rest is history.
Right.
And with the Muffins, it was the best of both worlds. We lived together, which was great, living with your band. You get very tight that way. And Dave Newhouse and Tom Scott were writing music that was, frankly, too difficult for us to play. So we would spend acres and centuries of time rehearsing all this stuff and combining that with free improvisation, which we could all do. You know, everybody in the band was a good enough listener that we could pull that off. And I still enjoy both. You know, give me the difficult music and, you know, give me the free stuff. You know, I have, and give me the heavy rock, give me the pretty music. I have no boundaries.
Right.
If I like a project, I'll do a project.
So tell me more about being a listener. Like the book does a great job at highlighting the eclectic music that your parents introduced you to, from church music to modern, you know, 20th century composition, tons of stuff. But you've mentioned listening a couple of times.
I was a listener since I was, you know, probably, you know, cognizant since I was probably 5 or 6 years old. I was just always fascinated with whatever was coming out of the stereo. And that in my parents' house, that could be Edgar Varese, it could be Stockhausen, it could be Gershwin, Leonard Bernstein, Mozart, you know, all over the map. Edith Piaf, Ema Sumac, you know, with all those records were in my dad's collection.
Yeah.
And so listening was always a fantasy for me. And still is. I still love hearing stuff that I don't know and enjoying it. I started out, believe it or not, playing the trumpet. And I was probably 8 or 9 years old at the time. And that got to be pretty boring because there wasn't much interesting music for me to play. And I had no help or encouragement from anybody other than my parents saying, play an instrument, you know, pretty much. Then when the Beatles rolled rock music back over our feet, and here in America, I got, of course, got into the rock and roll stuff, and tried to play the guitar, tried to play bass, and eventually settled on the drums, which I just had a natural aptitude for that I didn't know I had in about 1966, and that's where I've been ever since.
Something you've shared with me a few times is you have a regular practicing routine or something that you practice through?
I try to.
Which is the Stravinsky...
Yes. To prevent rust.
Uh-huh.
When I don't have people around to play with, which is unfortunately too much of the time, I will put on the headphones and I will listen to piano reductions of Stravinsky's Rider Spring. Another favorite of mine is Inostera's Estancia Ballet, mm-hmm. which are just amazing when played on the piano. And with the piano, your rhythmic possibilities, because the piano is in fact a percussion instrument, that's where it lives in the orchestra. The rhythmic possibilities with that music are just astounding. So there's no way you could learn every nuance, so I'd play it a different way every time, and it would still fit, and to basically just keep my chops up.
Mm-hmm. And what got you started doing that kind of work? Like, what made you think, you know what, I'm gonna play drums along with this? You know, most people don't do that.
Well, those pieces of music were already favorites of mine. Uh-huh. You know, I grew up with this stuff.
Yeah.
And when piano versions of it became... Actually, when the Muffins... Dave Newhouse will remember this, and Billy Swan. When the Muffins were winding down, I went and got the sheet music for the piano, for the Michael Tilson Thomas version of the Rite of Spring, mm-hmm. and printed out the parts that made me crazy, like Adoration de la Terra, mm-hmm. for instance, you know. Da, 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 you know. I had to print that stuff out and look where the beats were to learn it. And I spent months doing that, driving everybody in the house nuts. But it was a tremendous amount of fun, and I still do it to this day.
Yeah, so what are some other parts of your listening and practice, you know, that help you keep your drumming unique and up in shape, you know?
Oh, gosh. Well, finding people to play with out here, as you well know, I've had a hard time with that until very recently, when I've met a great bass player who used to own a record store in the Phoenix area called Bullfrog Records.
Hmm.
People that were here 10, 20 years ago might remember him. His name is David Poff. And he has moved back into the Phoenix area and expressed an interest in working with me. So we've been working together regularly. And we're going to get tight, work out some arrangements, learn some systems, get to know each other a little better. And again, starting a project with the bass player. Mm-hmm. Because in my opinion, if you're going to build a band that has a bass and drums rhythm section, if that doesn't work, you're doomed. Doesn't matter what else you bring in, okay? But that's got to work. So we're going to get tight and then present ourselves, you know, to certain people, mm-hmm. and see who we can inveigle to work with us.
So you find working with other interesting musicians is a key way for you to stay fresh?
I learn something every day when I play with other people. Mm-hmm. Every day. Always learn.
I know you have a history with Robert Fripp.
Yep.
You mentioned him in your book a few times, and I know a lot of people who watch this channel enjoy, you know, Fracture and King Crimson
sure.
related stuff. So
yeah.
Why don't you share your history with Robert?
Well, King Crimson were one of my very, very, very early influences. The first King Crimson hit when I was, 15 or 16, and it just upended pretty much everything I thought about rock music to that time. And I was listening to the Moody Blues and one of my favorite rock bands of all time, the Yardbirds,
yeah.
who I still love.
Yeah.
I just loved King Crimson, and it's no secret that most of the second album, or large parts of the second album, are Holst.
Mm-hmm.
So I, of course, love that. Now, I love Mellotrons, although I find they've been almost used to abuse in the so-called prog rock world. But anyway, Fripp, interesting story. We started our relationship with Giorgio Gomelski, this was the Muffins, back in 1978, and Giorgio tracked me down and scared me to death, which is in the book.
Yeah.
We eventually, you know, settled on that the Muffins would work at his now legendary Zoo Festival, which is the first progressive rock festival ever in the United States. It was in New York in October of 1978 at the Intermedia Theater.
I think my dad was at that show.
Your dad was at that show. I've had that happen a lot lately. That's funny. I think he did mention that to me. But the long and short of it is, I ended up running sound for the whole thing, except when I was playing. The sound guy that Giorgio had targeted for this thing bailed the week before the festival. And so Giorgio, the only person that he'd ever talked to that also had that kind of experience was me. Mm-hmm. So he rang me up and he goes, "Paul, you can do the sound." So I kind of went, okay, whatever. So I went up there a few days before the festival, and the sound system was installed at Intermedia, and it was a Pink Floyd rental PA. They had phase linear 700 watt power amplifiers that had custom made Pink Floyd front panels. I tried to acquire one, but no dice. So to get the training on the sound system, it was suggested that I go and work with the Pink Floyd guy and for an Art Ensemble of Chicago concert with Lester Bowie. So David Allen went to the show too. Mm-hmm. So I went there and learned how to use that PA with the AECO, the Art Ensemble of Chicago, that had 50 acoustic instruments on the stage, which mm-hmm. was its own little nightmare, but nowhere as bad as the Zoo Festival was. But so anyway, the day I arrived to go up there and work with the PA, I walk into Giorgio's house, and he says to me, "Paul, go into the living room, have a glass of wine." I go in there, and there is Robert Fripp and Debbie Harry quaffing Prosecco or something, which is Robert's, one of his favorite drinks. And so we got to know each other quite casually then, and Giorgio invited them to the festival, and they actually came and sat right in front of the mixing board for most of the day. So we had a great time hanging out, you know. Uh-huh. And Robert was a very, very friendly, polite, normal guy, and Debbie Harry was beautiful, lovely, lovely lady. And then I didn't talk to him again until email became available. And a very funny thing happened. Mark Cherig and somebody else who used to work with King Crimson were trying to get a hold of Robert Fripp, and he and I had been corresponding. Now, these emails ended up at Cuneiform Records, and Steve Feigenbaum said, "Paul Sears knows that he communicates with Robert Fripp. I'll send your emails to him." So he sent me these emails, and I forwarded them off to Robert, and I said, "These guys are trying to find you to get a hold of, to get their hands on some old recordings." And so Robert wrote back, and he was very funny and nice, and we've been in touch ever since, and I've seen him a couple of times since then, socially. He's taken me on a tour of Worcester Cathedral, and when I went over there last year, I let him know that I was going to be in town, because, you know, he had moved away from, he lived in Devon for the longest time, and then he bailed and moved to Worcester. So I wrote to him and told him I was coming over there, and he says, "Well, I'm really busy then, but we're having a friends and family King Crimson show on this date in October, and you're welcome to come." And in his words, "You can bring as many chums as you like." So I said, "This is too cool to be true." So sure enough, he just asked me to send his the names to his manager, David Salt, who also manages Stephen Wilson, that man in the clouds. So to that King Crimson concert, I took my son, his wife, my grandson, my son's wife's mom, a friend of my son's, and I had been hanging out with Ken Pustelnik, the drummer from the Groundhogs, and so I invited him too, and he went, "Sure." So I got a lot of people into that show for free. Thank you, Robert Fripp. That was a lot of fun, and I'll never forget the expression on my son's face when Crimson started off with Larks One, uh-huh. with three drummers.
Yeah.
That was a golden moment for me.
Powerful.
Yeah, a lot of fun.
Yeah, absolutely. And I was just listening to that record the other day, and I hadn't listened to the original recording of Lark's One in years. You know, you hear, I've got their Meltdown DVD, you know, you hear live recordings, you hear people covering it. But when I heard the original one, and all of the buildup, and then the drums come in, you know, and it was so powerful. I was getting the chills just standing here working.
What? Jamie Muir was incredible.
Unbelievable.
There are some videos on the internet with Jamie playing that. Watch them.
I will check it out. So there's a special, I guess, a gesture or a permission that Robert gave you with respect to the book. Why don't you share?
Oh, sure. That was neat. I had been doing some sessions with Jonathan Sindelman, mm-hmm. and the great bass player Campbell, with Spencer Campbell, and later on Michael Manring, you know, whatever. And these were all interesting experiments that were generated by my good friend and publisher Ken Kaufman. Mm-hmm. So anyway, John was staying at my house for a few days, and he's, besides being one of the funniest people on earth, a lot of laughs with that guy.
Yeah.
He wanted to record a cover tune just for spits and giggles.
Yeah.
And so we were just tossing ideas back and forth, and we settled up on Lark's Tongues Part 2. Let's do that. So, okay, so we'll do that. So Robert, John goes back to California, and about a month later, he sent me an immaculate keyboard recording of Lark's 2. And so I put drums on it, all live, one take. Uh-huh. And then I went back and did my best Jamie Muir imitation, Low Rent, and put on some percussion and sent it to John. He liked it, mixed it, sent it back to me. And it was just so cool. A couple of years later, I thought, geez, I'd like to play this on my radio show. But knowing Robert, and I want to get it out on the table now, that I don't know Robert Fripp very well. Uh-huh. To say that I know him well would be a grotesque exaggeration.
Right.
But I knew Robert well enough where I thought, well, okay, I can make an MP3 of this thing and send it to him and gently ask his permission.
Right.
Which he came right back and said, rock on, fine, all okay with me. So then, fast forward a couple years.
You asked for his permission to what?
I asked him for if I could play that on my radio show.
Oh, okay, right.
You know, because right. I'm a gentleman that way.
Yep.
You know, so not in many other ways, but in that way I am. So anyway, I asked Robert, and he said, fine, no problem. Mm-hmm. A couple years later go by, and when my book became a real project, Bruce Hellington, the singer from 9353, said to me, you know, Paul, you really ought to include a CD with that book. And I thought, that's a great idea. But I have to get permission from an awful lot of people,
right.
and other record companies, because most of my work today is playing on other people's stuff. You know, I play on other people's records. Now, the Fripp thing I thought was really, really neat. And so I thought, I'll ask Robert if I can put this on my book CD. And I wrote that email, and I sat on it for about 3 days before I pushed send. I thought, do I want to risk our decent relationship on something like this? I don't know. And I thought, well, the worst he can do is tell me no.
Right.
Boom. Hit yes. Send. 2 days later, he came back to me right after New Year's. Happy New Year. All good with me. Love, Robert.
kind of thing. That's like, great.
Sweet. Yeah, right. So that was neat.
So tell the audience about the CD that comes with the book.
There is a CD that comes with my book, Angels and Demons That Play, that contains a sampling of various works that I have been lucky enough to play on, starting in about 1980 with the Muffins, all the way up till the last recording that's on the disc. I tried to put it quasi-chronologically. I tried mm-hmm. to keep it that way with T.S. Henry Webb and Jerry Goodman, the great violinist who was with Mahavishnu and mm-hmm. Dixie Dregs and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the CD is great. It's a really great thing to accompany this book, and that's another thing that I feel makes this book.
I had to like run all those tracks through SoundForge to make sure all the levels were compatible, so that people didn't blow up their speakers.
Right. Yeah. Cool. But I think it's just a testimony to. I mean, this book is so dense with musical detail and knowledge and your history, and there are a lot of kind of autobiographies that just come out and they're just autobiographies. But
well, there's more history than knowledge there.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd like to just point that out. Point that out to my readers.
But the CD is like the perfect complement to the book. So I think it's really great and it's unique. And I'm glad that we have Ken Kaufman.
I'm really happy with it. My publisher did me right. Yeah. It's a beautiful product.
Yeah.
We're just hoping the book does well. It's garnering some nice reviews out on Amazon.
Mm-hmm. So, speaking of, or going back to 185, we had mentioned that earlier, and earlier in the interview just now, you had said 185 is your favorite Muffins record.
Absolutely.
One of your favorite records you've ever done.
Absolutely. The favorite record.
But in the book, you said the reviews weren't great, and
no.
I kind of agreed with them.
Well, the reviews weren't great. I'm not sure I said that.
You did.
Well, okay.
I'm going to look it up.
If you can find that.
Yeah, I want to find the exact
words. 185, we were, I think, about 5 years too late with that record, because by the time that record actually hit the market, the punk scene in the Washington area.
So, yeah, the aftermath of 185 was very anticlimactic. It was not well received in reviews, and I found myself agreeing with the reviews.
What you're reading there is Tom Scott's excerpt, not mine.
Oh, okay. That makes sense, then.
When? Okay.
No. All right. So, then tell us about 185.
Well, here's what happened. We had a much closer relationship with Fred Frith than mm-hmm. anybody else back then from the Virgin Records camp. We got to know Fred at the Zoo Festival personally. However, Fred had contributed guitar pieces to the first Random Radar Records sampler record, which was a done deal before I ever met the Muffins. Hmm. That was something I just couldn't believe. You've already got these relationships going with these people. Nice. So out of the blue, 1 year, I think it was in 79, Fred rang us up and asked me if we wanted to be on his album on Gravity, which was his first project, that wasn't a guitar solos record, and this was compositions, and sort of different flavors of music, and we jumped at the chance. And Fred by then was living in New York, and he came down to our place in Maryland, and we recorded one side of the album at his direction. The great Swedish Samla Mamas Mana recorded the other side, and Fred took these things back to Switzerland and Sweden and tarted them up and finished the album, which is beautiful, immaculate, and that came out great. Some months later, Fred rang us up and suggested, I'd like to produce a record with you lot. So we went for, we jumped at that, of course, and we had some friends who were willing to throw some money at us so we could go into a real nice, analog studio and do this, and that actually eventually happened, and we ended up doing the record at Track Recorders in Silver Spring, Maryland with Fred, and it was a perfect storm because we had just finished a small tour, so there was no, oh geez, we have to learn this music before we make the record. None of that. We just walked right in and hammered it, And it was the only record that we've ever made like that. And the band had never, ever, ever been that tight.
Mm-hmm.
That's the reason I like it.
Oh, because of the...
It was completely organic.
Okay.
Everybody knew how to play the stuff. Crack, crack, crack. Boom. Done. We'd been playing it for a couple of years,
right?
And we just done 5 or 6 gigs,
right?
Like the week before,
yeah.
So there was no question of knowing it,
right?
Going back to Robert Fripp,
yeah.
I don't think I'm not sure if he does this now, but I remember reading something that he said a long time ago. I'm pretty sure if I'm recalling correctly, he didn't like to record anything until it had been played live. Uh-huh. And that I agree with. Mm. The Muffins' first album, Manor Mirage, which is our most consistent seller, was recorded before we really knew how to play the stuff well. Mm-hmm. But that record sells on the merit of the music, you know. Mm-hmm. The music's very well written, very well done.
Now, you're a man who clearly doesn't have strong opinions. No, you have a lot of opinions in the book, and I think it's great. And
but then again, I have a lot of flexibility, and I have a very wide musical compass.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I'm not afraid of anything, right. And I will listen to any music.
So I found it interesting in the book. You call yourself a contrarian, and
pretty much
you try to defy labels.
I just don't like them. It's not a matter of defying them. Okay. I just don't like the application.
All right.
I find labels to be prisons.
Yeah. So I think that's very representative of your playing and the music that you play or that you've recorded through, you know, and that you dictate in the book. 'Cause a lot of your music, you talk about how women didn't like your music, and you finally, like,
when I was a kid, that was a real problem. That was a barometer, let me tell you.
Right.
Let me tell you, man. That's very, actually very funny. But back in those days, there were a few people around me, guys, uh-huh. that were adventurous in their listening, and they somewhat influenced me. And so I was listening to, for the uninitiated, you know, older Frank Zappa and Henry Cow and Magma and Sun Ra and Stockhausen. And if you're not into that sort of thing, it could be kind of a put off. Sit well with the dames back then.
Yes, and you detail, you know, the difficulty with your first wife.
Oh, it was kind of funny. Yeah, yeah, right.
And then leading to Deb Sears.
Yeah, it wasn't really difficulty. She just wasn't. She thought it was really cool that I did it, but did she really like it? Nah.
Yeah, that's how my wife is. She says, I don't like the music that you make, but I'm really glad you make music.
My present wife is very supportive.
Yeah.
And she will give anything a listen. And that's why we have an enormous collection of optical media, uh-huh. CDs and DVDs. And we have a little bit of overlap. But I learned stuff from her because she turns me on to stuff that I've never heard of. And I turn her on to stuff that she's never heard of. Mm-hmm. So there's a symbiosis there. And it's healthy.
I brought up opinions and kind of the desire to not be labeled because I think the book describes a lot of the hardships that you've gone through to even survive as a musician and the hardships that you've seen friends and peers also suffer through as musicians, just trying to struggle and make artistic music. If you were starting today, do you feel like this is a climate that would be open to what you experienced over the decades?
I would be absolutely terrified as a starter outer today, with the way the business has evaporated and evolved into the snot ball that it is now. You know, I feel very bad. There's so much good music out there, and it's all in disparate locations, and you know, it's all pretty much Since the internet became available widely and broadband and all that stuff, and everybody's doing DIY and remote projects, and if you're touring and selling merchandise, seems to be the only way to survive now.
Mm-hmm. So can you...
Unless you're very lucky.
Yeah, so there is a chapter where you kind of digress from the music and you talk about politics.
Yes.
And hearing you know, your thoughts on the Constitution and Democrats, Republicans, political parties, it made me wonder, you don't really talk much about the music business. And
well, that's completely different. That's the music business is just like it's just media in general. You know, it's opportunities have shrunk. Yeah. And it's all being run now by conglomerates that are owned by the same people.
Right. So it was interesting because your description of how politicians are corrupt today and how money doesn't go to the right place.
Not just today.
Well, true. How it has become worse reminded me of the music industry itself. It was like people have found ways to skim and skim and skim until there's just nothing left to skim for the people who are doing the work.
Well, I have to hand it to people who take the stuff back and do it themselves. And I think one of the more successful ones is actually Robert Fripp.
Yeah.
You know, he's gone and gotten back all the rights to all his work, mm-hmm. and he has his own infrastructure for the distribution of his own music,
right.
which is wonderful. Prince was the same way.
Mm-hmm.
I remember Prince, I remember reading, he actually called up the guy that started Napster and said, get my stuff off your servers. Now.
Did it work?
I don't know.
But
I have enormous respect for him for taking all his stuff back.
Uh-huh.
You know.
Yeah, so in today's kind of share everything and everything is free kind of...
I don't like that.
I want to hear about that. What don't you like?
Well, I can tell you, I have one of my main record labels tries to police that stuff.
Uh-huh.
And I have been ripped up by jackasses on YouTube who think that our music should just be free to them.
Right.
You know, who do we think we are? Well, we're the guys that own the rights to this, and we're the ones that made it. Who are you? What have you brought to the table, pretty much? The evidence is everywhere. Stupidity has replaced hydrogen as the fundamental building block in this universe.
Okay, great.
I'm paraphrasing Frank Zappa.
Yes.
Yes.
So you also share some interesting stories growing up in Washington, particularly. I remember a story about how you and your friends would play either loud or difficult music while J. Edgar Hoover was...
Oh, no. Here's what happened. A school buddy of mine, Bob Siegel, who's still a pal, he was either about to or was dating my little sister. Uh-huh. And he asked me one day, he says, would you like to come play with our power trio with this band that he had with this bass player named Peter Olson? Sure, whatever, you know. So we start rehearsing at his house, which was in 30th Place in Washington, D.C., in a very ritzy neighborhood where a lot of rich Jewish people call and that call home. And that neighborhood is called colloquially Hanukkah Heights.
Mm.
I love it. So anyway, Bob's house, when I was setting up the drums and I put my drum cases in the back room, there was this huge telephone switch back there,
mm-hmm.
that was the size of, it was bigger than an electric piano.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, what is up with that? And he goes, well, my dad bought this house from LBJ when he became vice president. So that was his telephone switchboard. So that's interesting. So then he tells me, he says, guess who lives right over there? J. Edgar Hoover. Now, J. Edgar Hoover was a very paranoid guy.
Yeah.
This is kind of public information.
Right.
He commuted a lot from that house when we were there. He was absolutely unwilling to get out of his car if anybody was standing on the street. So if we were hanging out there, we would make sure we were all hanging around outside, smoking cigarettes, and we'd kill an extra 20 minutes just to watch him sit and sweat in his car. He wouldn't get out of it until we went inside.
And the Secret Service would just...
They'd just sit there. No, these were cops.
Okay, but they didn't bother
you? It wasn't the Secret Service. It was the FBI. No, they couldn't bother him. He lived there. I mean, Bob's father was, as I recall, was on the board of directors of the Washington Post.
Okay.
So he was a pretty well-known guy. And, you know, you wouldn't want to make an enemy like that. So, anyway, Hoover was just paranoid. I mean, he was just absolutely, utterly paranoid. And when we were in a really, when we were feeling really obnoxious, we would take one of the PA cabinets outside, put it in the driveway, and aim it at Hoover's house, and then go have band practice for 3 hours. We were obnoxious.
Yeah, so I think that's kind of representative of the rock and opposition movement, you know.
Well, this was real rock and opposition,
right?
But anyway, no, those were fun times, and it was a great band.
Uh-huh.
Bobby put CDs out of both of those bands, Same Day and Tinsel Tin,
uh-huh.
recorded live in 1972 and 73.
Uh-huh.
So those constitute my first actual recordings. And Same Day, we actually recorded a 45 back in 1972, but I don't even have a copy of that.
Uh-huh.
Very sad.
So given that your music is challenging, and you describe it as angular and
sometimes,
you know, atonal at times, what was the response from audiences as you're going around? I'm sure you saw a difference between European audiences and American audiences. Like,
Absolutely. Well, in Europe, music and culture and art in general is taken a lot more seriously by street level people. Mm-hmm. You will find much more support anywhere in Europe than you will find in the United States, almost anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
In America, there's some great stuff being done, but it doesn't get an awful lot of support. People have to really, really jump on the treadmill and push things themselves to get anything done. I mean, you know, it's very difficult.
So tell us about the audiences themselves as you're performing. You know, let's say you go out and you're playing, you know, a Muffins concert for a new audience. How was it received?
It was sort of hot and cold. Sometimes uh-huh. it was great, sometimes not so great.
Yeah.
Sometimes horrible. But, you know, we believed in what we were doing, and we kept doing it anyway. You know, damn the torpedoes.
Right.
You know? And we had a great time doing it. We had a lot of fun making that music, and it was certainly an esprit de corps team effort. You know, mm-hmm. we had some support. We had some rabid fans. We had very close friends that encouraged us.
Mm-hmm.
And lo and behold, you know, we ended up building a fan base that was international before the internet.
Now, you and I have been in Arizona trying to do some music and art stuff for several years. Arizona is an interesting place. It's not, it's got a lot of culture in some respects and then no culture in other respects, you know, with respect mm-hmm. to artistic music.
And it varies greatly from place to place.
Yeah.
In the town that I live in, it's called Superior, there's virtually no live music scene. None. Mm-hmm. Zero.
Yeah.
Zilch. We're trying to change that. Baby steps.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we'll see what happens. Not long ago, I went down to visit my friend T.S. Henry Webb
mm-hmm.
Down in Bisbee. And Bisbee's a much bigger town, but what I liked about it, as opposed to some other towns I've been to here in Arizona, was that down near where they call Whiskey Row, there's 7 or 8 live music venues within a 5-minute walk. You know, you won't find karaoke, you won't find hip hop, or any of that other evil on music, you know. I may not like all the stuff that they're playing down there. It's mostly blues and
right.
you know, and rock and roll stuff, but it's live organic music, and I'll give that a shot.
Mm.
And it's you could just walk 5 or 10 minutes and there's a half a dozen places to play.
So
that's kind of neat.
That begs the question, what brought you to Arizona? Like, why come out from what I think people here perceive to be a much more culturally rich area, like the Northeast, well, you know, the older cities.
And it's then, okay. This is a good question. That's a very good question, and I'll tell you why we're here. Back in 2009, my wife and I decided that we've had enough of the United of the East Coast. Mm-hmm. In fact, we had enough of the U.S. We were going to go to the south of France. We were actually looking at houses in the area where we know a bunch of people in the areas of a town called Mirepoix. Mm. Just beautiful. However, anybody can go buy a house in France. But if you actually want to go live there, that's a whole nother animal and a bunch of paperwork and quarantining your dogs and moving, you know, your 3,000 pounds of stuff, in my case. Mm-hmm. So that just wasn't practical. Mm. Now, my friends, the Davidson brothers, who are here in Arizona, and I've been visiting them since the 90s, have been bugging me to move out here for years. My wife used to live out here back in the 70s and the early 80s. And I said, yeah, look at some houses. The prices that she found out here back then in 2010 were just jaw-dropping.
Yeah,
I mean, so
astoundingly cheap.
Astoundingly, yes, astounding. Yeah, we did very well with real estate. So I flew out here and stayed with my friend John, and he gave me a car to drive so I could work with his realtor friends and go around and look at properties. And the house that I used to have in Apache Junction with this big separate building, which was my first Garage Mahal, which you remember, mm-hmm. It was just too stupid a price to turn down. So we decided to, okay, seat of the pants, buy the house, move to Arizona. And we've been here now almost 9 years.
Yeah. Well, what is it, just the financial aspect, really?
Well, that was and the weather.
Okay.
You know, I've never enjoyed being in the snow relocation business.
Right.
Yeah, hated it. We lived, the last place we lived in was Baltimore.
Yeah.
And the town was then and is now and will tomorrow have a lot of problems.
Yeah.
And so we just had it. And so we bailed.
What have you found that you love about Arizona?
Cactus.
Yeah.
No, about Arizona, I love the weather out here. I like the cost of living is substantially lower than anywhere on the East Coast that I've been. Mm-hmm. You look at Baltimore, D.C., New York, and then you look at the Phoenix area, and you get out farther away from Phoenix in the valley farther east like we did. It's just a huge difference. I was able to have room to have a studio, which I really, in Baltimore, imagine all the stuff that I have now in, you know, 350 feet.
Right.
You know, you couldn't walk around in there.
Oh, yeah.
Walk down there at night in your bare feet, suicidal.
Right.
Yeah, so, really enjoy being out here in Arizona. I wish there was more opportunity to play live.
Yeah.
But I'm available, anybody. Give me a gig. I'm available to work with anybody if I like their stuff.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. I mean, maybe I'm reading into your book differently than you intended, but to see, you know, your description of how you see politics, the fact that you grew up near Washington, D.C.
I was born right down the street from the White House.
Right. And you stayed there in that
area. In fact, Chris Cutler was born there too.
Chris Cutler from Henry Cow.
Yep. Chris Cutler from Henry Cow was born in D.C.
Were you guys childhood friends?
No, later. No, later, much later. But he was born in D.C. and I tried to get out of him what hospital he was born at to see if we were born in the same hospital.
So
I don't think he ever found that information, but he's definitely born in D.C.
But you stayed in the D.C. area for 40
years?
Oh,
off and on most of my life. Yeah, I had family there. I owned real estate there. Mm-hmm. I had a lot of friends. But it was just getting old.
Yeah. I think it's a testimony to how cities are becoming so expensive and difficult for creatives.
And crowded.
Yeah, and you see,
I mean, the congestion in the areas surrounding Washington, D.C., almost defy description. Yeah. It's so awful.
And you look at even more temperate places like San Francisco or Seattle, and the tech companies are driving real estate up so much that musicians can't afford to live there. I know many musicians.
That's a fact.
In those areas, that happened, who can't survive.
That happened in Telluride.
Yep.
Happened in Jerome.
Yep.
I mean, you know, the real estate prices up there are just, the people that were there keeping the town going can no longer afford to live there.
So ultimately, I just want this interview to be a big commercial to get all you creatives to move to Arizona.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so for people who may have no exposure to your music, what might you say to compel them to read this?
Go to my website, look at my videos, listen to my music, and if you want my book with the CD to annoy your friends and family, purchase the book directly from the publisher at stairwaypress.com.
Awesome. Cool. Paul, thank you so much.
Thank you, Anthony.
For making it out today. I really appreciate it, man.
No, it's fun knowing you over the last few years.
Thank you very much. Oh, I guess before we go, I think we should at least say something about the band that we had started for a few months.
Oh, that was a hoot. That's a funny story. I had been in Arizona for less than a year, and I was in my studio crying, who am I going to play with? And I'd been advertising on Facebook and Craigslist and, oh God, a bunch of different places I tried to find people. And I got writ to by this kid named Anthony Garone, who asked me, did I know Andy West? And I had to say, I don't know him. I'm a big fan. Why do you ask? And Anthony's response was, well, I do, and we'd like to play with you.
Yeah, so your Craigslist ad, which I saw, because I search Craigslist every now and again for Frank Zappa, yeah. King Crimson, right. Gentle Giant, Henry Cow, you know, just to see if
you had to have been surprised when you saw me.
Right, so you're like every once in a while an ad actually shows up, yeah, and sure enough, there was yours, and then you said, I'm Paul Sears, I'm the drummer from The Muffins, and I wrote to Andy, and I was like, you know The Muffins, right? And he goes, oh yeah, they're awesome. He's like, I have all their CDs. It's like, well, the drummer is here and he's looking for people to play with. And he's like, well, that sounds interesting. So that's my side of it.
But, well, that was fun. And I'm sorry that...
What ended up happening was
you guys gave me a list of tunes you wanted to play.
Yeah.
As I recall, Vanity Vanity by Fred Frith.
Yep.
Red by King Crimson.
Mm-hmm.
One More Red Nightmare by King Crimson.
Mm-hmm.
And Peaches and Regalia by Frank Zappa.
That's right, yeah.
Those were the tunes.
Those were the tunes.
So you two showed up, and your dad,
yep,
who was a fantastic singer, and he did John Wetton justice, in my opinion.
Yeah.
We played together a few times, and then Andy called a lunch down by some office down in Sutter and Chandler or Tempe or somewhere, I forget where it was, and suggested that we do a band.
Yeah.
I thought, great, this is going to be a band. And it ended up being the timing wasn't right,
yeah,
and Andy didn't have time to do it, so unfortunately, and then we came up with a really goofy name. Nobody knew what to call the band, so these guys came up with Swag. SW@G Sears West and the Garones, which I thought was kind of cool.
I even had my
graphics guy do a logo.
We have a poster.
I have a poster. So,
I still have video footage of us practicing.
So do I think. Yeah.
So yeah, that was our brief musical work together. But I look forward to more. I'm really glad that you're here because you've come to so many of our concerts and you know so many great people. So it's been awesome to get to know you over the last
I have been year. Blessed yeah. in that direction. Fortunate yeah. to know so many great people.
Right on.
Yes, very much.
Cool. Thanks a lot, Paul. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Anthony.
All right, man. All right, let's get some lunch.
Let's go. Go, man.